Good morning, Bedford Acres. Thank you so much for joining us with Online Church. And this morning, as we kind of go throughout this season of not being together, I just want to encourage you guys, you know, God is still ever present in all of this, and He's still doing something with all of this. And some of us are, you know, obviously spread out a lot more than others. Right now, I'm in Tennessee at my mother-in-law's house. And so, you know, we're having to do things from home, and things are a little bit different. But the building is just a building. It's where we meet and we fellowship together, but the church is the people, and so we have to remember that. So this morning, as we kind of go into this, I just want to pray for us and get us started in the service. God, we love You, and we thank You for everything that You're doing and everything that You're going to do through this COVID-19 situation. God, we know that You are the healer and You are the great physician, but God, we also know that You have a plan and You allow things to happen to bring You glory, God, and we just ask that we seek that versus our own agenda, God. We love You and we praise You, and we thank You for everything You continuously give us, God. In Your holy name we pray. Amen. Let's worship.
was heavy, the chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, but now you call me a citizen of heaven.
That happen, and there are situations that we have zero control over. And you know what's funny is when you think about when you ask God, like, God, you know, I just want your will. I just want your will to be done. Do we really mean that? You know, I think a lot about, you know, when Jesus was in the garden with his disciples, and
he said, God, if there is any other way, Father, if there is any other way, let this cup pass from me. And there wasn't. And Jesus was okay with that. I'm sure he wasn't happy about it. But he was okay with it. Because ultimately it is God's will. It's not our will. It's whatever God needs to have done, it will happen. And we have to be okay with that. And stop falling asleep in the garden and pay attention.
Good morning, church. So glad that you could join us today for this virtual version of our Sunday morning worship. Obviously, we're not at the church building right now, but we're glad you joined us anyway. Also, I want to mention, feel free to share this with others. If you're watching this now, you probably saw the link either on Facebook or an email or on our church website. Please feel free to share this, and maybe we can get some folks that don't normally have a chance to attend to come out. But again, we are so glad you're here. Let's open with a word of prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for the opportunity to still share your word with folks. Certainly, we want to lift up our nation, our people, during this time where we're all facing this coronavirus issue. And keep us safe. But also, Lord, even though the church doors are closed, help us all to remember that the church is not closed. We are very much alive and very much able to do and should do what we have been called to do, to take your word and the truth of Jesus Christ to the people. Bless now this message, and certainly, Lord, all those that may not be watching this, but they're watching their own church service in the comfort of their own home, maybe with their family around them. And Lord, we claim by faith and thank you that your word will not come back void. In Jesus' name, amen. Have you ever thought about the power of symbols? All around the world, people recognize the golden arches of McDonald's, the Nike swoosh, or the Mickey Mouse ears of the Disneyland and Disney World businesses. But even in religion, symbols are quickly recognizable. The Star of David, the Jewish star, and of course the Islamic star and crescent. Now, no symbol, though, is more recognizable than the cross. And no symbol probably emotes more emotions than the cross or some of these other symbols as well. But a child expects to get a happy meal when they see the golden arches. The Star of David arouses pride in the Jewish people and hatred among many others. But what about the cross? For some people, the cross is very, very sacred. And for others, it is simply fashion. For some, it's a call and a reminder of faith. And for others, it's a call to arms. And as we approach the Easter season, we're going to take a couple weeks and we're going to be looking at the cross. And specifically, we want to see what was the impact of the cross. We will see that the impact that it had 2,000 years ago is very much like the impact that it has today. Some were unmoved. Some didn't bother them at all. Some were saved because they saw the cross. And like the disciples of old, we hope that we as believers are inspired by it. So plan on joining us, not just this week, but the next couple weeks as we see the impact of the cross. Someone once said that God took the worst thing that man could do to his son and transformed it into the best thing that he could do for man. And while the Roman soldiers were unmoved, certainly as those beneath the cross, we need to see that some today are still unmoved. In Mark chapter 15, verse 22 through 24, we read these words. It says, they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him, dividing up his clothes. They cast lots to see what each would get. The first thing I think we can see with those soldiers who were unmoved by the cross is that familiarity had bred contempt. You see, crucifixions were very, very routine for these soldiers. Matter of fact, many of the soldiers, that was their duty all the time. So they would have seen hundreds, maybe thousands of crucifixions during their time in the military. Do you recognize the names of Carla Faye Tucker or Harold McQueen? Maybe in the back of your mind you say, oh, that seems vaguely familiar. Well, Harold McQueen was executed at Eddyville State Prison in July 1st of 1997. He became the first man executed in the state of Kentucky since 1962, nearly 35 years between the two. Carla Faye Tucker was a woman who was executed in Texas back on February 3rd, 1988, and she became the first woman executed in Texas since the Civil War. Now, I'm not here to talk about capital punishment, but certainly capital punishment has been on the increase in our society over the last couple decades, but it's still far from the norm. But in Jesus' day, public executions were very, very common. And these men at the foot of the cross, these Roman soldiers, were numbed by that routine. Skip Grady, a Jewish fellow, writes about a Jewish tradition that held that when Jesus was still a teenager, still living in Nazareth with his parents, that the Roman army actually crushed a rebellion, a revolt, and to make sure that it did not happen again in that area, they crucified an Israelite every 10 meters for a distance of 16 kilometers. That would literally mean 1,760 people, give or take, were left on crosses spaced about 11 or 12 yards apart for 10 miles. So long before Jesus would tell his disciples that the Son of Man would be crucified, he would have had this indelible picture in his mind of what that would mean. These soldiers had done this so many times that they could now do it as routine, as casual, even on a playful manner. They were simply following orders, orders that they had followed time and time again. But when you think about it, is our culture that different? Has the cross maybe become too familiar today? I heard about a lady who went into a jewelry store to buy a gold cross, and she's asked by a young clerk, "Do you want a plain one or one of those with a little man on it?" The cross is not about a piece of gold, and it's certainly not about one with a little man on it. Several years ago, over the years, we have seen that famous athletes, rock stars, movie stars, and celebrities, you know, oftentimes we see them wearing necklaces or earrings that are crosses. And I'm sure some of them wear them for legitimate symbols of their faith. Others, it's nothing more than a trendy piece of jewelry. Several years ago, when Madonna was still very popular, someone asked her why she always wore those huge crosses, and her reply was simple: crosses are in. But is it possible that those who attend church regularly, that for us, that maybe it too can be familiar, that we're maybe not moved by it like we once were? Maybe you were brought up in church your whole life. Maybe you, like my children, went to church before you were born. Maybe you know all the songs. Maybe you've taken communion thousands of times. You've gone to youth rallies, camps, retreats. You've read the books. But now you realize that the cross maybe is not moving you like it once did. And like the Church of Ephesus, if we're honest, in Revelation, maybe if we really took inventory, we'd realize that we too have possibly lost our first love. If that is the case for you today, I want us to join together and take a good look at the cross, a really good look at what this really was. The imagery itself is brutal. The Jews condemned it. The Romans even despised it. In the Old Testament, in Deuteronomy chapter 21, it says in verse 23, "You must not leave his body on the tree overnight. Be sure to bury him that same day, because anyone who is hung on a tree is under God's curse. You must not desecrate the land the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance." The purpose of a crucifixion was simple. It was to deter crime. The Romans were very, very tolerant and believed in diversity as far as belief and religion, but they would not tolerate crime, and they would absolutely not tolerate any kind of rebellion. The rebels' utter humiliation began on the way to the crucifixion site itself. They would be forced to wear a plaque or a tablet around their neck that would tell what their crime was. The condemned person would actually carry the cross, more likely the cross beam themselves. And if you remember the story of Jesus, he fell under the weight of that, and a fellow had to come along and carry it for him. And once the person was nailed to the cross, that conviction notice was hung above their head to let everybody know why they were there. But even before the actual crucifixion, the condemned person was stripped naked. Certainly we've seen pictures and statues that, you know, have a sort of a cloth or something that would hide that level of indignity. But that wasn't the way it really was. They would have been stripped naked, their clothes would be divided by the soldiers, and in Jesus' case, and it was often, they would actually do this by gambling. Many times the victim would have been scourged beforehand. This was a brutal beating. I mean, it would literally expose not only the bones, but the sinews and the tissues, and sometimes even their internal organs would have been exposed from such a brutal beating. And then this person without this in a crucifixion could possibly last 2 or 3 days. A person who had been scourged, you know, shock would take place, loss of blood, things like that, that would certainly expedite the death. But, you know, naked, bleeding, humiliated, the person would be nailed to a cross through the wrists and feet. The cross would oftentimes have a peg positioned in the midsection for the victim to have an uncomfortable place to sit. Remember, the purpose of a crucifixion was to be a slow, painful, and public death. It was to deter others from whatever crime that person had done. The person was usually not far off the ground. Again, in pictures and movies and representations of this, we often see them elevated pretty high off the ground. That would not have been the case. They were very often just barely off the ground. And so not only could birds of prey get in them, because they're birds, but other animals could get to them and tear at their body. If there was no one to claim the body, a person would literally hang there until the elements and the animals consumed the body. There was a wonderful picture one time of a little girl holding the hands of Jesus, and she's looking up at him, and she asks very simply as she looks at him, "What happened to your hands?" That's a question we need to ask. We need to ask ourselves that regularly. We need to remember as we look at the cross, and we need to see what really, really happened there, and we need to know why. What happened to his hands? And what happened to his hands happened because of you. It happened to me. Please, please don't ever let us become too familiar with this. Another issue that the O's under the cross, the soldiers had that led to their being unmoved was prejudice. Their prejudice led to indifference. The Romans hated the Jews, and the feeling was very mutual. The Jews were a proud and arrogant and independent people, and the Romans literally hated being stationed in Palestine. And this hatred allowed these men at this crucifixion and others to not see a Savior. They just saw one more criminal. And maybe you can relate to that. Maybe where you are right now, you have a hard time seeing the cross because of the prejudice that you may have developed over time against certain church people. Maybe you were sick and no one called to check on you. Maybe you lost a loved one and nobody from the church reached out at all. You went through a divorce and not only did you face the pain of that, but maybe you were ostracized or felt like the church bailed out on you. Maybe at some point you had a financial need and you felt like the church let you down when you needed them the most. A lady commented one time that the only time in her life that she'd ever seen her daddy cry was when he told her his mother had gone to the church when he was a child during the Depression. She'd asked for the church to help, but they refused. She came home in tears. And from that time on in his life, he was indifferent toward the church. Maybe he'd been cheated on by a church member, exploited by a church member. Maybe you've been through a situation where a preacher did something or had a moral failure that has kind of turned you off to the Lord. Please don't let the imperfections of God's people keep you away from Jesus. He's the perfect solution to our sinfulness. C.S. Lewis was a brilliant English scholar who had trouble getting past Christians in order to get to Christ. When he went to church, he hated the hymns. He said that most were second-rate poetry set to third-rate tunes. But C.S. Lewis read about Jesus in the Bible, and he became one of Christianity's most prolific apologists. In his book, Mere Christianity, and that book itself has probably done more to influence skeptics than any other single book in history. Another issue I think we see with the soldiers who were unmoved is their worldly focus kept them from seeing Jesus. While Jesus was praying for their sins, they were gambling for his clothes. In John chapter 19, verse 23 and 24, it says, "When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes, dividing them into four shares, one for each of them. With the undergarment remaining, the garment was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. Let's not tear it, they said to one another. Let's decide by lot who gets it. This happened that the scripture might be fulfilled, which said, 'They divided my garments among them, and they cast lots for my clothing.'" So this is what the soldiers did. Maybe the reason the cross does not move you or as it should or once as it used to, maybe it's because of too many of the things of the world. You know, if the theater's ever open again, if you go to the theater, you know, they have several times in there that they remind you to turn off your cell phone. Because, you know, nobody wants to pay to watch a movie and then hear you on your cell phone or see the light as you're texting somebody. So they ask you to take that off. You know, we even have an announcement loop at church to encourage people to remember to silence their phones. But yet it still happens. People forget. Matter of fact, last week when we were filming the service, I had not silenced mine, and I had a text alert come in my pocket while I was taping the sermon itself. So we're all subject to that. But I remember one time, and I certainly understand the oversight, but we had a guy one time in the church I was preaching in Louisville that actually had a phone call come in during the sermon, and he actually answered it and had a conversation without leaving the service. It may not be that the cell phone is what's getting your attention. It may be the grocery list you're working on instead of really listening to this. It might be your plans to do yard work today because it's going to be maybe it's going to be nice enough to do that. Have you ever been in one of those situations where you're, you know, at the church service and you're just absolutely moved to tears by the Holy Spirit just working with you, maybe the message, maybe the songs, but somehow God is just really moving in you. And you step out of the sanctuary, and the first thing that happens is somebody that's, you know, comes up and says, "Hey, how about those cats? How far are we going to make an NCAA or whatever?" And it seems like that individual clearly did not get what was going on. They were distracted, and maybe they have added to your distraction. Have you ever had your head focused down on the things of the world? Maybe that's where you are. You're just, you know, "I'm just so worried about this coronavirus. I'm so worried about my family. I'm worried about the financial impact." And so it's hard to look up and see Jesus when we're focused on those things. But do yourself a favor. Force yourself to turn off the news. Turn off the cell phone. Shift the gears in your mind. Set aside the thoughts that are kind of distractions, you know, and look at Jesus, you know, just for a few minutes and see him as truly the author and the finisher of our faith. I remember vividly in the movie Titanic, there was a very sobering scene that really makes this point. As the band was playing in the background, "Near My God to Thee," there's a group of people sitting in a bar. And while that song is going on in the background, one of them says, "Another brandy, please." As we see the cross today, don't look away. Look right at it. This life is really a Titanic for all of us, isn't it? And it's what we focus on now that is going to impact us for eternity. So how could these soldiers be at the very foot of the cross and not see the Savior? Well, the cross had become too familiar. Their prejudice blinded their hearts, and their focus was on the wrong things. But what about you? But what about me? What about us right now? If you have never become a Christ follower, why not? Could it be some of those same things that the soldiers are facing? Perhaps you've heard this story time and time again. I'm going to ask you right now, just for once, maybe ever, really, really, really look at the cross. There was a statement I saw. It was on a t-shirt, I believe, or a poster of some sort at a Christian bookstore many, many years ago, probably 30 years ago now. And I remember seeing it, and I remember it brought me to tears. And I've thought about this over the years, and basically it was a statement that said this: "I asked Jesus, 'How much do you love me?' And he said, 'This much.' And he stretched out his arms and died." I want you to do something right now, right there on your couch or on your phone, wherever you're watching this. You know, if you're driving, don't do this. But I want you to just close your eyes right now. And I want you to see the cross. I want you to see his pain. And I want you to get this in your mind. I want you to see that he, while he was going through this, was thinking about you. I want you to envision yourself asking him like that person asked on that poster, "Jesus, how much do you love me?" And I want you to hear him say and visualize this much, as he stretched out his arms and died. Let's pray. Father, we love you so much. And we thank you that even though we can't meet together in person, we can meet together like this. And Lord, you promise that your word will not come back void. And I know this has been a shorter sermon. It's been relatively simple. Doesn't need to be more than that. But we trust by faith that your word will not come back void, that someone listening right now, that it will be used by your Holy Spirit, these truths, that they would draw once again to you, that they would, if they've never accepted you, seek that out. If they are a believer and they've kind of lost that first love, that this would be a challenge for them to come back. As we're reminded in 1 John, that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God, we thank you for the cross. Lord, help us not to be like those soldiers who were unmoved. Amen. Thanks again for joining us today in our virtual worship service. Please feel free to pass this along to others who may benefit from it as well. In these uncharted waters, we are all facing new challenges, sometimes new every day. But we have a loving Heavenly Father who knows what we're going through. He's not just all-knowing, though. He's also all-loving. He loved us so much that He made a way for us to have a relationship with Him, even though our sin has created this incredible barrier. More than any other time, the Easter season is a reminder to all of us of the great lengths He was willing to go to redeem us. If you listened to the message today, hopefully something encouraged you or piqued your interest in this incredible Redeemer God. Perhaps for the first time in a long time, or ever, you are considering your relationship with Him. Maybe it's time to reconnect to what you once had, or to take a step of faith and reach out for forgiveness and restoration. I promise you, it's a very simple process. First, you just need to admit you're a sinner. The Bible tells us in the book of Romans that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's you, that's me, it doesn't matter whether you're a preacher, a poet, or a pauper. We are all sinners. And we need to agree with God on that. He says we are, we need to acknowledge, yes, I admit, I am a sinner. And because of that, I deserve everything that goes with that. I deserve death. The second thing is admit you cannot fix it on your own. The Bible tells us that even our righteousness, our goodness, is like a dirty rag in comparison to His holiness. We just can't be good enough to earn forgiveness and salvation. Lots of people try. They think they can be religious enough. They can give enough money. They can do a balancing act where they do more good than bad. But the Bible just says that won't work. So we need to admit that we can't fix it ourselves. Then we need to accept by faith that Jesus is good enough. That what He actually did on the cross, what we talked about in these sermons, that in His death, His being buried and coming back to life, defeating death, hell, and the grave, did in fact pay the price for all of our sins. Matter of fact, one of the things that Jesus said on the cross, one of the last things He said was, "It is finished." And what He was saying is the debt had been paid. It had been paid in full. Then the next thing you need to do is to commit your life to Him. You need to make a conscious decision to let Him be the Lord or the boss of your life. Up till now, we've all been doing our own thing, calling your own shots, and we need to come to a place where we say, you know what, I'm going to let you be the master. Commit to living our lives with His help in a way that honors Him and follows the example of Jesus. It's called being a disciple, and we're called to be that. And you can actually pray and ask Him simply to forgive you as you trust Him to do that. Maybe something like this. You could say, "Dear Lord, I acknowledge I'm a sinner. I know I can't save myself. I'm a wreck. I do confess that I can't fix it. And I'm trusting you, and I'm asking you right now, do number one, forgive me. Help me to live a life that honors you and come into my heart." You can do that right now in any way you want, but God hears the prayers of sinners. And He's waiting to hear from you and anybody else that wants to do that. And if you're serious about this, if this is a step you really know you need to take and you want to take and you're willing to do that, then you need to follow that up by not only doing that, but being willing to tell other people that you are now a believer in Jesus Christ. And to be baptized. The Bible tells us in obedience, that's the first step that we need to do after accepting Christ. You need to do that. And you need to plug into a good Bible-believing church. If it's not Bedford Acres, there's plenty others out there. But and even if now it can only be in a virtual setting, we'd love to help you with this. And if we can help you with this, maybe you've got questions, please reach out to us. You can reach out to us via our office email. That's office@bedfordacres.com. Or you can call the church office. That's 859-987-4591. Now, because we're pretty much on shutdown there too, most of the office staff is working at home. But someone is checking the messages on a regular basis. As a matter of fact, the phone is usually actually being forwarded to somebody, and that will could come back to me or to one of our other staff that would love to talk to you, email you, whatever, somehow help you understand this in depth. Please do this if it's something you feel you need to, and I promise you we will get back to you and follow up with this. And again, thank you so much for being a part of our service. Pass it on. It's very important for all of us as members of the church or not, to stay in communication with each other. Don't hesitate utilizing our email, text, phone numbers. We've got a tremendous online presence right now. We've got a Facebook page for Bedford Acres. We've got a website. Bedford, www.bedfordacres.com, and obviously the email updates. So make sure you're following up and check up on each other. Thank you so much, and God bless.